Amen.
Amen.
So here we are, right? We're here on this morning of time change and chaos and basically another morning in the world, right? And we hear about Abraham, who looked at the chaos and said, cool, I'll do that, God. And we hear about Nicodemus, who had just a few more questions. I find Nicodemus to be the most relatable person in Scripture. Well, except for Peter when he screws up. Because Nicodemus doesn't just jump right in. And I tend to not be a jump in the deep end kind of person, so this makes perfect sense to me. But what we learn is that we have to set aside those things that pull us away from God. And we learn that both from Abraham, because he's willing to leave behind everything to do God's calling. We also learn it from Nicodemus. While he's slower to do it, he also comes to the same place. So I'm going to give you a little scripture shorthand. If someone's name is mentioned anywhere in the New Testament, particularly if it's mentioned in the Gospels, that means the church that the person writing the Gospel was writing to knew that person, knew of that person, and was acquainted with who they were. So that tells us that Nicodemus had an active role in the early church after Jesus' ascension. That tells us that he is known to John's church. And that tells us that not only did he come to the point where he accepted that Jesus was the Son of God, but he became an active follower. Okay, nerd moment over. You see, here's Nicodemus coming in darkness to the light, asking questions of God, leaving confused, then standing up at his trial and speaking on Jesus' behalf. And then, when Jesus is buried, we know that Nicodemus is one of the two men who provides for his burial. Nicodemus is willing to put his money where his mouth is. See, while it's slow, he still arrives at the point of turning away from being afraid of all who will turn against him and following Christ. And that's what we're called to do. It takes us all different amounts of time. And there are moments in our lives where we have a choice between giving into fear or following God. And we will choose wrong some of the time, and we will choose correctly the other part of the time. And that's normal. Do you know who's really good at choosing the wrong side of that? You know who else? Probably everybody else out there. Do you know who's really good at recognizing when I need God? When everything's falling apart? But it's after years of practice, so don't think I just started that way. Right, when the chips are down, they have to be really, really down. So I want to talk about that fear for just a moment. Because we are in a country now where people are making a lot of money off of selling us fear. have a strong belief that all of our sins are rooted in fear. If you go down the list of the seven deadly sins, all of them, if you take another direction, are good things. You need to eat, but gluttony is bad. Right? You need rest. God gave us the Sabbath day. Sloth, however, where you just never leave the Sabbath day, is bad. See where I'm going? And all of those things happen when we're afraid. We are given a choice to do like Abraham and like Nicodemus, to follow God, or a choice to stay put. When we give in to our fears, we are following Satan. When we take the stand to follow Christ, the blessings that come from that are unfounded. They just keep multiplying, and we can't count them. So, what are we going to choose? You heard me tell the kids it doesn't matter when you get there, right? I really want to make sure we understand that. For some of us, it takes as long as we are alive. And I do think that there's a time when God's like, I'm still here. For some of us, we get it right away. Doesn't matter. When God talked about Abraham's family, does anybody remember the story? What does he tell Abraham to go out and do? Oh, everyone's children's Bible should be rewritten. Okay? He tells them to go out and count the stars. How many of you have been able to count all the stars in the sky? Abraham's in a desert, and he says, your descendants will number more than the grains of sand. He's in a desert. So what Abraham does by saying yes and not giving in to his fear is he provides a blessing for all of us. He provides us for a place where all of us are part of that family. So here we are in this crazy Lent. I'm going to invite you all to think of this time period as not one of lack and of less, but one of great blessing. So many blessings that you cannot count them. An invitation every moment of this Lent to turn away from our fear and to go straight towards the cross. Because in the end, there is nothing that we do that is going to earn us that blessing. Paul said it in Romans. We are not being paid for good behavior. It is a gift. There's nothing we can do to earn it. There's nothing we can do to lose it. All we have to do is open our hands and take it. Our salvation is laid in one thing only. Extra bonus points if you know what that is. The life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the fact that God just loves us that much. And we belong. So, welcome to this season of blessing. May it light all the dark spots in your heart. May your blessings